rolling.
Conference, are you ready?
Well, you know, no, but let's see what we can do.
All right, Conference is now going to give a presentation, and it's going to be from her current work experience. And I think that whereas what Mark was talking about sort of is, and some may disagree with me, but it kind of seems to me to be at the extreme end of how we approach these projects, as an example. Constance is going to talk about a scenario where she's actually kind of working as the architect, but also doing architecting, kind of blending with the architect and the systems engineer, which is yet another modality. So, and then after Constance, I believe I'll get up and probably talk about my FR's experience, which is yet another permutation. And then we'll have David kind of finalize the whole thing by talking about how our practice is done on Earth. So, no? Oh, no.
It's a problem with the special.
Oh, so it's buildings, yes, with footings and things like that. That's fine. All right.
And don't worry, I'll be using the hell out of it. Okay, what I'm dealing with now is embracing the team that we have, you know, in the past sometimes set up ourselves as considering the enemy. In other words, those who have no design education and claim to be doing architecture. So what I'm doing is ISS system architecture in that mode, but as an architect, and approaching it with, you know, the same sort of idea about there being organizing structure and about what the end goal is supposed to be and about the process being an ongoing product, something that, you know, here I came in just about a month and a half ago, and the space station has been flying for several years, as most of you are aware. There has been a healthcare system aboard the station for several years, as most of you are aware. And there are to date no requirements documents for that system. The relationship between items that are on orbit and anything that we might consider a managed system or an organized project is negative, not even zero, which would be a sort of neutral place to be. Consequently, it's an interesting experience, and you know, I'm just sitting here working out these diagrams as we go, so this is not going to be a nice, clean presentation about a case study. On the other hand, this is the belly of the beast, people. We can make this work if there's hope. And if we can't, then I'm not going to pardon myself. But so I'm going to try to the acoustics in here really strange, a lot of white noise. I'm going to try to diagram out the way things are working now. Relative to relationships of the people who are doing what. Give you some sort of idea of how much fun I'm having. And then try to diagram out where the requirements documents should be, according to which things would be built if they were working, which is sort of my holy grail this year, is to get two most antagonistic directors at the Johnson Space Center, SA, which is Space and Life Sciences, and EA, which is Engineering, to lock them in a room together in a couple of months' time. And I'm not going to let them out until there's a concept of operations document. I'm already notorious for having a name that I'm planning on doing that, so we'll see what happens. All right. Right now, there is a client. That client represents the International Space Station Program Office, and that is OE. There are people aboard the space station, well, two, whom we are hoping to serve with our products. There is. So barely communication of any kind between these two. If that's exciting, we at least see a lack of communication between these people and the people building the hardware. That's, I'm going to put hardware here. Okay, that's engineer, right there, EA. EA, at this level, at the director level, has a team that's supposed to be dealing. Checks, these things dying. System management. See how easy that is? If I'm managing something and I'm okay over here, okay, there's no communication going on between me and any of the people generating the requirements. They also have a branch, EB, you hear from them a lot, that's the biomedical systems. And they are supposed to be building the hardware, providing the hardware. Okay? So we're managing the system, they're providing the hardware. These guys are flying and they don't know where, you know, where the note came in. So who's taking care of them on hardware? The day-to-day basis we have under SD, we have biomedical engineers. These people are supposed to be supporting the crew from the console in mission control 24/7. NetOps also do is you've got flight ops. And you've got training. This is the only space station training group that is not part of the Mission Operations Directorate, where all other training and simulators are supported. Over here, we've got manifesting, kidding. Over here, we're providing hardware. And we are doing resupply. Kidding, by the way, includes, we've got a little room with a cipher lock on it where we put the drugs into the pack. All right? We don't have a pharmacy. So, now, missing some manifest kidding and resupply. Oh, we also do checks console. Which means supposedly system management is sitting with the biomedical engineers. Well, we are. There is somebody on our payroll sitting with the biomedical engineers in mission control talking to the crew. What nobody has, all right, is inventory. Status. And this is, system management is here, but the relationship between all these things is such that actual management and oversight has been very interesting to achieve, especially because we're talking about flight ops. Manifesting is over here, right? But the launch manifest for every single expedition is uniquely created and signed off by a flight op. And it goes directly to kidding. It skips system management, it skips inventory. It skips the VMEs. Which means the people who are sitting there on console providing immediate support to the crew have no idea what's on its way off. So this is a living system that has no requirements documents. Now the new hardware that's being developed will be required to be producing PTRS, which are prime technical requirements specifications. Prime item technical requirements specifications. 25, there's a group of about six that do that like crazy all the time. Manifesting, one. Four. Kidding, three. Got three people kidding. And that means if they need to make a kid, they can make. Okay, so people with advanced engineering degrees, stitching, you know, men's pockets to put drugs into and blah. Checks console at the moment, we have one. He's a little over.
There's just a web, nine bucks.
Yeah. Well, and I've only seen, and mind you, I've only seen two of them. The rest of them don't have time to answer an email because they are. Okay. Now, people supporting the flight dogs, okay, here's a group that support the flight dogs. They do a great job and they knock themselves out. That's about another, well, really three people. They've got a little auxiliary support. There's about three people, most of them nurses with, you know, aerospace medical backgrounds and stuff like that. They're good at looking for hardware. So what these people do is they go out and do a search. They pick a piece of hardware. They throw it over the fence over here to people who have no requirements that they know that they have to meet, nor do they have requirements to verify it for their hardware. And yet, if something breaks on orbit, who's going to be responsible for it? And meanwhile, in the middle of all of this, we're going to Mars. This is just a space station program that is. And this is the entire medical program for the U.S. Human Spaceflight Program. And by the way, we don't talk to international partners. Officially, there's a chain of communication from these guys over to the Sioux. I've never heard of communication with ESA or NASA medical personnel. But occasionally they talk with the Russians about various medical issues, but they've got their own kit up there. So we're talking about medical kits your size for the whole crew, but half the crew already has them.
I have two questions of clarification.
Yes?
If it's the people on the left side of the crew that are actually developing and filling out the manifest, what is that person doing?
Guy has to lead to keep track of what we have.
So that's sort of the by default inventory?
Yes. Well, because his job is to do up manifests, right? So what he's doing is on every is to plan ahead for every flight that we've got going. You know, we're always struck. I mean, every system that's got up mass plans is duking it out with every other system to get mass on every flight up, right? Especially now. We've got a system that's designed around getting all of our drugs back at the end of every increment. And of course, we haven't seen anything in a year and a half. So we don't know how much the crew is consuming. We don't have a bar. This guy is tracking all of the resupply flights and basically and trying to get feedback from the whole biomedical community and from the crew about what is required. So what drugs are expiring on orbit. And he is also supposed to track what it is that gets put in progress and trashed. In theory, all expired drugs that, you know, duly noted, bing, 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 it goes in progress and is trashed. So you don't have a barcode to go from. So,
question two. Can we actually
The way that this has worked so far, the lock-in was in there, I had to cut it.
The green one, right?
So, yeah.
Whoa, today.
All right. Now. After 6 weeks, I'm beginning to get a grip on how we might want to demonstrate what a little architecting can do.
Can I just, regarding the medical, you said that they don't talk to international partners and stuff, but there, for whenever a European flies to the station, there is a console at EAC and one other place, I think somewhere in France, that they're building in Columbus as well. And there's always a flight schedule on there as well. They do have requirements of IMOP and other committees. And there is always an ESA flight schedule based at JSC as well.
Yes.
So,
and there's a Russian one.
So why do you say they don't talk to each other?
Well, I'm sure that they must. But when we try to find out what, for example, is on, in the Russian kits, or what the current condition of the crew is, or who's on console, or how they have responded to a scenario that's up like this. It's a piece of the puzzle that after a bit of experience and fairly aggressive digging, I still have no insight.
But there is also the thing of medical confidentiality with regards to the crew. So as long as it doesn't impact the mission, I don't think they're obliged to give that.
It does impact the mission. It impacts the mission that we need to know. I mean, it's not about that. Though that is often something that gets thrown up there. Medical confidentiality, you can't talk. Medical confidentiality, you can't say a word. Okay, we've got enough antidepressants up there to put a small herd of cattle to a very big moon on.
As long as they believe it does not impact the mission, they should not be telling you. Because, there's a special relationship that astronauts develop with the doctors.
They don't have responsibility for something to go wrong. So their belief as to whether or not something impacts the mission is really sufficient. We still need to know what it is that we need to be providing, what needs to be supplied.
But if
they're not keeping inventory,
if that's
they were doing the job.
Okay. I'd like to offer a clarification.
Could I just make one more point there? That might be the case.
Why don't you come up?
No, I'm just making a point. The Russians believe the way you believe, that there is no medical confidentiality.
Yeah, we need to
All right.
Thanks, Rico.
I'm getting off base. This is a very important issue. I'd like to just issue a clarification. There are two problems. One is a general overarching problem for all of space station, and the other one pertains particularly to medical confidentiality. The general problem is there is very poor tracking of consumables, and if you go to NASA Watch, you'll see an article that was just posted in the last day or two about how they lost track of the oxygen supply and consumption on the station, and part of that had to do with the fact that the Russians ditched a Progress freighter that had half of the oxygen resupply that was planned to be offloaded onto the station without offloading it, and so without delivering it to the station. And so this is every area, whether it's the oxygen, the space pens, the pills, there isn't a good way to track how much is being used and how much is available still there. That's number one. So they wouldn't even know if they ran out of antidepressants because they're not counting how many they're using. And so that does become mission threatening or life threatening if you use up all your antibiotic and nobody knows that.
Well, I don't think that the flight surgeons have no idea how much drugs they've got left.
Constance is right. No, two, with medical confidentiality.
Okay, let's return to the
All right, we can do this later.
Professional practice of aerospace architecture. I'm sorry.
Here's what we're trying to do, all right? Because in the end, while at the moment, we have only one customer, space station, suddenly we also have Code U, and what are they now calling Code T?
Office of Exploration.
Yeah, so. We also have another customer on the horizon that's getting noisy. And in principle, we're not learning anything from our space station medical program if things are as confused as they are. We are, in fact, learning nothing right now from what we're doing, except that this is not really a business. So, what I'm trying to do is to organize the relationships that should be strongest. Our main countermeasures, TVIS, which is the treadmill, has been breaking from very early on in the history of the space station, and somehow has to be fixed on orbit. This is one of the items that was famously designed in-house by people who had never designed a piece of exercise equipment or, in fact, anything at all before, rather than going out of the box and buying a treadmill and adapting it for the purposes of on orbit. Environmental health, we've got, basically, we've got big microbial sampling and contamination sampling issues. Several of them were talked about yesterday at the very conference. I guess NWAC was one of the more recent issues, which was the water, the coliform detection kits that they were trying to develop. In HMS, an item that's hot right now is the defibrillator. One, it doesn't work. Two, it did, but it shorted the whole station out. We don't know. What am I trying to get created? I'm trying, first of all, in October, I am locking the door on EA and SA until they have a concept of operations and utilization document in place, according to which at least any future hardware for the space station and in principle, the basis for future hardware for any other missions can be developed in some kind of rational process. From there, we want to finish turning up functional requirements documents for each of these three. At the moment, there's a draft FRD that covers everything. It's really more sort of la-la land above the time ops. And at least the flight surgeon and the engineers are talking about that back in the meeting on it, so we're getting somewhere. Yeah, so that's an example, I guess, for these items, then prime item technical requirements for each of the pieces of hardware that can be written according to a template is actually verifiable. So the other product I'm trying to develop right now, the VAST, it's one of my acronyms, the Virtual Activity Simulation Tool, is actually being designed for design assessment of any kind of hardware or procedures, assessment of procedures in an IBA microgravity environment. So including virtual tool, we're working with a virtual astronaut. We're leveraging off a lot of things that already exist. There's a model of space station in development that's built on the SimCity and SimEarth mirror worlds, and it's called SimStation. A virtual astronaut is a quite remarkable model that was developed by MOD at the Johnson Space Center. It's anthropometrically very accurate, so you've got real world motion. It can also it can be sized to meet the size of any astronaut. It can also reflect musculoskeletal degeneration over a certain period of time on orbit, so your strength aspects are going to be changing according to the measure what the crew is able to do. We're also using haptics and some force feedback to put then, first of all, the hardware developer, and then the verifying team, and then in the end, ideally training into this microgravity environment, and actually start measuring how these hardware items are going to work. So, in other words, I'm trying to get requirements that define the system, requirements that call out the program, right, the functional element. So this is kind of a master plan. This is kind of a programming document. And then these are going to be your blueprints, or more like your specs, right? Your hardware is going to be your blueprint. And this is the ability to us to verify that the hardware that is developed does in fact lead to plans. So that's the project I have at work right now. Any questions? Questions?
It seems extraordinary.
product. And the between games are specific products aimed at making that. All right, so the product itself, crude healthcare system. A functional crude healthcare system that can support ISS as it is moving towards being launched. And, you know, so that we can make sure that the next time you buy a respirator, the next time you buy a defibrillator,
where do you take your capabilities as a traditional architect with your training that you have? How does that apply to this?
Well, I guess the ability to envision this diagram right here is a part of it. I mean, you know, the very first part of schematic design involves sort of diagramming of, you know, what's, you know, let's look at my context, what's my environment, who are the players, who are my customers, who is supporting me, you know, where is my information going to come from, and then how do I want, you know, and then what is it that I want to be creating, and how do I want to do that, which includes
3D visualization and troubleshooting and problem solving. That's five architecture and design tools.
You know, and also in a building, you don't want communication corridors that are always crossing. It's, you know, you don't want to waste, you know, 30% of your floor area of circulation space. You want to shorten your communication corridors and make sure that the functions that need to be next to one another are next to one another. That's exactly what I'm trying to do.
One comment just about when I was at JSC, one of the things which I thought affected the communication between respective parties was the way the campus is laid out. You know, like if mission specialists sit in building X and payload specialists somewhere else, I mean, they don't get to run into each other, for example. I'm just giving a hypothetical example, but I think the layout does affect communication in an organization, especially in bureaucracy. The architectural site layout, it makes a big difference.
I thought about that, and I agree with you in certain cases, and in other cases I can see the other point, which is that, it's a problem actually that NASA has had traditionally, you know, that showed up with Challenger, is knowing the difference between a developmental project and an operational one. In the development phase of a project, I absolutely agree that what we really want is for the representative of each one of these specialties to be sitting together, you know, with the other representatives in the working group as it's being developed. But once it's operational, it is often helpful for manifest people to be with manifest people so they know the other manifest people are working on here, so they can train interns to be taking over their job. And frankly, you know, with the telecoms and electronic interfaces, I mean, I sit off-site right now. And I'm sure it would be, you know, my communication time may be shortened in a certain way.